Good morning to everybody. Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to declare open the 26th session of the Conference of the Parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Dear delegates, after 2 years, it is indeed a pleasure to see you all in person. However, the past 2 years has been difficult. Some of us lost family, friends, and colleagues. Please join me for a minute of silence in remembrance of the many lives lost around the world during the coronavirus pandemic. As we adjust to life with COVID-19, let me remind everyone of the COVID protocols in place to keep you safe and healthy during the conference. Please maintain 1 meter distance from the participants, and participants must wear face coverings except when eating, drinking, sitting in office spaces or meeting, sitting to perform negotiations, or are medically exempt. As hygiene crew will enter promptly at the end of our allotted time to disinfect all surfaces before the next meeting begins. We ask for your cooperation to exit the session promptly so that the cleaning can begin. Excellencias, distinguidos.
Excellencies, distinguished delegates, friends. 2 years after the last time we met with this pandemic, which we had not experienced for centuries, is forcing us to take care of ourselves, and I'm delighted that we can actually meet in person today. Today, we are passing on the presidency of the COP, the longest presidency of the process. We accepted to take over the presidency of the COP on behalf of Latin America and the Caribbean region, COP25. Took place in complicated circumstances, and Chile, with conviction, gave a step forward, stepped up when others were stepping back. I would like to acknowledge the bravery, the courage of Sebastián Piñera, the president, who took that brave decision and stayed unwavering, committed to this endeavor, despite all the difficulties we had to face in these years of our presidency. As president of COP25, Chile did everything it could to lead the process and to do so with transparency, inclusively and ambitiously. This process is a process of the parties, it being understood that the final outcome is the responsibility of the consensus of each and every one. As president, I, with my team, drove forward the integrity for us to implement the Paris Agreement. We know that to tackle climate change calls for cross-cutting transformation of our modes of development. That is why, as the presidency, we convened COP25, the finance ministers, the ministers for energy, the ministers for science, the ministers for transport, and the ministers for agriculture, to drive forward this multi-sectoral transformative change to combat climate change. The first decision of COP25 we took together, and we recognized that science was non-negotiable. It's the basis on which we need to take our decisions to bring about this transformation. And it was unprecedented, and we took on board the oceans in the COP process. Our understanding is that the negotiations of the parties are the key to achieve a successful process. But we also know that inclusion, the inclusion of non-state actors, civil society, private sector, as a driver for innovation and technological change, need to be taken into account. The sub-regional governments need to be taken on board so that we can implement our decisions regionally, as well as the financial institutions. Only by bringing all these people on board will we achieve the ambition we want at the speed, the pace we need also. At COP25, we said this clearly. It is time for us to act. That is why, together, we renewed the mandate of the champions, and we launched the Global Ambitious Alliance for Carbon Neutrality, which, thanks to the joint work of the champions of Chile and the United Kingdom, and thanks to the Race to Zero, we have been able to exponentially increase the involvement of NGOs, non-state actors, so that everybody can be taken on, bring about this transformative change. Over 7,000 institutions have went to that COP, including and $90 trillion worth of commitment. We have committed ourselves to act by 2050 with specific actions that are science-based. As president of the COP, we managed to renew adaptation and to make it commensurate with mitigation. That is why we renewed the WIM, as well as the Santiago Network, for technical assistance for adaptation. And together with the incoming presidency and the champions, we launched a campaign called Raise to Resilience, whose concrete aim is to reduce vulnerability to climate change affecting 4 billion people, and this by 2030. Putting people at the heart of the process must be always our main goal. That is why the gender plan needs to be implemented, so that we can have a climate change combat that is just and inclusive and does not widen the gaps and the inequalities that exist already in this world. Nothing would have been possible at COP25 without the support and the conviction and the work of so many people, to whom today I would like to pay tribute and thank. Thank you, especially to Spain, and in particular to Pedro Sanchez and his ecological transition minister, Teresa Ribera, so the president and the minister, who was committed to the climate change emergency and to committed to multilateralism and to peer-to-peer country solidarity, thanks to which COP25 could take place in 2019. But beyond the political colours of the governments in power, we, the Chileans, and the governments, Spanish. The Spanish have been our allies, our brothers and sisters in COP25 for us to combat climate change. Thank you. Patricia Espinosa, also thank you. She's a Latin American woman. As you know, she's a great leader and a very dear friend. She's the Executive Secretary of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Her advice and support, and the support and advice of all the team of the Secretariat, as well as the support of the Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, have all been crucial to enable us to give continuity to the process and to maintain the momentum, even in the hardest of times brought about by the pandemic. For me, it was an honor to be president on behalf of my country. It was a lengthy honor, a major honor. I would like to thank all the teams of the various ministries of Chile and the negotiating teams also, who joined this challenging work with conviction, with enthusiasm, and a great deal of professionalism. I would like to speak to the members of the Bureau now, and to the delegation of Chile, and the delegations of all the countries, and in particular, the most vulnerable countries among us, who with so much effort travel, cover huge distances to be involved in such a process as this one. And this process must be transformative. The thousands of people who from our countries are contributing to bringing about changes. I would like to say to all of you also that it was worth it. I would also like to say to you that the presidency of COP enabled Chile in very difficult times, very complicated times, during which people were polarized politically and socially, we were able to generate a cross-cutting consensus in our country to build on what we had achieved and build solid state policy climate change actions that brings about change. Fulfilling the Paris outcome, we, working with science, were able to adopt in the Senate the framework change which sets the carbon limit and resilience by 2050, as called upon by science. We have acted with ambition in line with carbon neutrality. Our aim is to develop our ambitions at all levels of government to have clear adaptation targets and to drive forward a decarbonization process, establishing the immediate closure of the first carbon plants as soon as we became presidents. And we are going to close by 2025 65% of all our coal facilities. We have binding limits for all emissions sectors, or sectors that have emissions in our economy, and we have 400 concrete cross-sectoring actions to achieve carbon neutrality and the resilience of our country. Undoubtedly, these are major achievements. However, we know that we still have a lot to do. In Chile and worldwide, we are feeling the effects of climate change strongly. The citizens of the world are expecting a lot from the leaders of the COP. Our generation will not stop climate change today, but it must act with urgency to change mindsets and patterns that we need to be able to stop climate change. It is the youth whom we involved in the negotiating process, who, with their strength, their innovative capacity, and their ability to work cross-cuttingly outside the box, they will help us to generate the consensuses we need to achieve sustainable development that we all desire. I would like to thank the United Kingdom now, with whom we have been working very closely over the last 2 years. I'd like to thank the incoming president, Alok Sharma, who has devoted himself to making this process successful. And I'd like to thank all of his team, not only because you've decided to lead COP26, but also because you have made huge efforts for us to be able to be here in person in safe conditions, despite all the health restrictions imposed upon us by COVID. We know that the success of COP26 will be assessed chiefly in three areas: ambition, number one, finance, number two, and rules, number three. Today, we have a great gap in our ambitions. The Paris Agreement establishes two mandatory instruments to tackle climate change. More ambition and long-term climate strategies. These are the two areas. These are the two concrete instruments which all of us, the countries, must use to reduce that gap in our ambition. There are no other areas. We cannot rewrite the Paris Agreement. We need to enforce it. We need to abide by it. We need to fulfill it. We also need to be capable to establish a new level of financial resources mobilization by 2025, but also close the gap of the 100 billion that have been pledged or that we've committed ourselves to achieve. Finally, we need to establish a set of clear rules wherein the most important issue will be the enhanced transparency framework. There will not be an Article 6 without that framework. The COP process is based on trust, as well as common but shared responsibilities. That is what it's based upon. That is why, before we pass on the presidency of the COP, I would like to strongly and clearly appeal to the leaders of the G20, who today are meeting in Rome. I enjoin you to fulfill your commitments. Dear friends, I am optimistic. Multilateral processes are not easy, neither are they speedy, but agreements are crucial. Success does not lie in our divisions. It does not lie in seeking the guilty or overcome or defeating adversaries, but joining determination, thanks to which we were able to be faithful to our word and to ensure that our actions really do reflect what we talk about. You can still continue to rely on Chile. Thank you very much for your attention.
Distinguished delegates, I would like to invite you to turn to sub-item 2 of the provisional agenda for the session, election of the president of the Conference of the Parties at its 26th session. You may recall that, in accordance with Rule 22, paragraph 1 of the draft rules of the procedure being applied, the office of the President of the Conference of the Parties is subject to rotation among the five regional groups. We now continue the cycle with a president from the Western Europe and other states. It gives me great pleasure to propose that the conference elect by acclamation His Excellency Mr. Alok Sharma, who will serve as president of the conference at its 26th session. I declare His Excellency, Mr. Alok Sharma, elect President of the 26th session of the Conference of the Parties. I congratulate Mr. Sharma on his election and wish him every success in guiding the work of the conference. I now invite Mr. Sharma to take his seat on the podium.
Friends, it's an honour to speak to you today for the first time as COP president. And I want to thank my dear friend Carolina for her really strong leadership over the past 2 years. Friends, I'm very aware of the responsibility placed upon me in this role, and I do not underestimate the challenge. But let me start first by formally welcoming you to Glasgow. And I want to thank you for all your efforts in getting to the United Kingdom, which I know for some has been arduous due to the impacts of the pandemic. Indeed, for almost 2 years now, the pandemic has caused devastation and disruption to lives and livelihoods across the world. And I know this has particularly affected the least developed countries and the small island developing states. And because of the pandemic, as you know, we postponed COP26 by a year. But during that year, climate change did not take time off. And the IPCC report in August was a wake-up call for all of us. It made clear that the lights are flashing red on the climate dashboard. That report, agreed by 195 governments, makes clear that human activity is unequivocally the cause of global warming. And we know that the window to keep 1.5 degrees within reach is closing. I've been humbled to speak over this year with communities devastated by climate change. On a visit to Jomsom in Nepal, in the Hindu Kush region, I spoke to communities literally displaced from their homes from a combination of droughts and floods. In Barbuda, I met communities still suffering from the ravages of Hurricane Irma 4 years ago. I've spoken to the communities in East Africa fighting plagues of locusts spawned by climate change. And earlier this month, I spoke to a group of women in Madagascar, determinedly coping with what some describe as the first climate-induced famine in the world. Friends, in each of our countries, we are seeing the devastating impact of a changing climate. Floods, cyclones, wildfires, record temperatures. And we know that our shared planet is changing for the worse. And we can only address that together through this international system. And we know what we need to do, because 6 years ago in Paris, we agreed our shared goals. We said we would protect people and nature from the effects of climate change. We said we would get finance flowing to climate action. And we said we would limit the rise in global temperature to well below 2 degrees, pursuing efforts towards 1.5. The rapidly changing climate is sounding an alarm to the world to step up on adaptation, to address loss and damage, and to act now to keep 1.5 alive. And we know that this COP, COP26, is our last best hope to keep 1.5 in reach. Now, I know that we have an unprecedented negotiations agenda ahead of us, but I believe that this international system can deliver. It must deliver. And as COP president, I am committed to promoting transparency and inclusivity, and I will lead this conference in accordance with the draft rules of procedure and with the utmost respect for the party-driven nature of our process. In that spirit, I believe that we can resolve the outstanding issues. We can move the negotiations forward, and we can launch a decade of ever-increasing ambition and action. And together, we can seize the enormous opportunities for green growth, for good green jobs, for cheaper, cleaner power. But we need to hit the ground running to develop the solutions that we need. And that work, my friends, starts today. And we will succeed or fail as one. Astronauts speak of the intense emotion they feel when looking back at Earth from space, seeing it gleaming through the darkness of the cosmos. Incredible, improbable, and infinitely precious. And if we act now, and we act together, we can protect our precious planet. So let's come together over these 2 weeks and ensure that where Paris promised, Glasgow delivers. Thank you. Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, and honoured guests. This morning, we are honoured to have with us His Excellency Mr. Abdullah Shahid, President of the United Nations General Assembly, Mr. Huisung Lee, Chair of the Intergovernment Panel on Climate Change, Councillor Susan Aitken, Leader of Glasgow City Council, India Logan Riley, a representative of the Indigenous Peoples, and Ms. Patricia Espinosa, UNFCCC Executive Secretary. And it is now my pleasure to invite Councillor Susan Aitken, Leader of Glasgow City Council, to address the plenary. Councillor Aitken, you have the floor.
Thank you, President. Friends, it is my great pleasure, honour and responsibility to give the 26th United Nations Conference of the Parties the warmest of our famous welcomes to the city of Glasgow. There have been delays and uncertainties on our collective journey here. I'm extremely grateful to everyone who has worked in partnership with us as the host city to get us here to this point. But we are here now, and humanity looks to you and the work that you'll do over the next 2 weeks to fulfil the promise of Paris for a safer, sustainable, more equitable future for us all. Let the city of Glasgow and our people serve as an inspiration to you. This is a city that has been through some very tough times, but we have survived and thrived against the odds through resilience, innovation, imagination, a sense of community, a strong sense of social justice, humour and grit. These are all qualities that you'll need in abundance over the days ahead. And if you feel your determination flagging at any point, please take a walk outside, talk to a Glaswegian, and let the spirit that infuses this city infuse you too. And if, as you spend some time here, you feel yourself feeling a little bit bolder, a little bit ballsier, perhaps with a wee bit more swagger than usual, then that's just the Glasgow effect. Take inspiration too from Glasgow's climate ambition. If this post-industrial city, still living with the legacies of our high carbon past, can have a plan for net zero by 2030, then there should be no limit on your ambitions either. Let the example of pioneer cities like this one light your way to the actions that you must agree here to safeguard our climate and our ecology for future generations. Glasgow couldn't be prouder of being the host for this pivotal moment for the future of the planet that we all share. Like the rest of the world, we'll be watching and judging. Our demands and expectations of you will be high, but we'll also be cheering you on and wishing you all the heart and courage that you need for the task that you have ahead of you. Once again, welcome to Glasgow. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Aitken. It is now my pleasure to invite Ms. Patricia Espinosa, UNFCCC Executive Secretary, to address the plenary. Executive Secretary, you have the floor.
Honourable guests, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, our very long wait is over. It is with joy and enthusiasm that I officially welcome you to COP26. I thank the outgoing co-presidency of Chile and especially Minister Schmidt for their leadership in the last two challenging years. I also officially welcome the incoming UK presidency and Minister Sharma. I thank you for your collaborative efforts as we work together to make COP26 a resounding success. And to all of you, I say this, congratulations. Congratulations to those in this room, those watching online, and to everyone involved in this process. Think back on the last 2 years since we last met in Madrid. The early confusion, the pandemic, and what it could mean for our process. Think about the decisions we made together, the skills we developed together to take advantage of communication technologies. Think also of those we lost to COVID-19. Our hearts are with those who continue to suffer. But let us also acknowledge what we have accomplished. We have kept the process going. We have not let the pandemic stand in the way of addressing the most critical issue facing this generation and those to come. We are here because of you and your work. From the bottom of my heart, thank you. Let's ensure that work was not in vain. As Scottish poet Robert Burns once wrote, now is the day, Now is the hour. Colleagues, dear friends, we stand at a pivotal point in history. Humanity faces stark but clear choices. We either choose to achieve rapid and large-scale reductions of emissions to keep the goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees, or we accept that humanity faces a bleak future on this planet. We either choose to boost adaptation efforts to deal with current extreme weather disasters and build resilience to address future impacts, or we accept that more people will die, more families will suffer, and more economic harm will follow. We either choose to recognize that business as usual is not worth the devastating price we're paying and make the necessary transition to a more sustainable future, or we accept that we are investing in our own extinction. It's about much more than environment. It's about peace, stability, and the institutions we have built to promote the well-being of all. It is for these reasons and more that we must make progress here in Glasgow. We must make it a success, as President Sharma has just said. Success at COP, here at this COP, is entirely possible. Success is possible because we have the platform for action. The Paris Agreement is a covenant of hope with humanity. It has everything we need to achieve our climate goals. But to fully unleash its potential, we need full implementation. To get there, parties must finalize outstanding work under the agreement that has remained unfinished for far too long. Every day that goes by without being able to implement the Paris Agreement in full is a wasted day, the accumulation of which have real-world repercussions for people throughout the world, especially the most vulnerable. I call upon parties to complete the necessary work here at COP26 that will move us towards full implementation. Success is possible because we already know the pathway to solutions. The recently updated UN Climate Change NDC synthesis report showed that emissions continue to rise. That's the bad news. The good news is also showed that for those nations providing a new and updated NDC, emissions are projected to decrease by 2030. But the truth is that we need even more ambitions and all nations on board, especially the highest emitters in the G20, responsible for around 80% of global emissions. We also need to see provision of support to developing countries, another cornerstone of the Paris Agreement. With adequate support, emissions reductions can potentially be higher. This relates to the commitment to mobilize 100 billion from developed countries to developing countries. The delivery plan announced last week should be seen as a start, not the end. It's important to follow through with more detail and concrete actions. But let us be clear, without the necessary support, we will not be able to embark on the transformations needed to achieve the 1.5 degree goal. This is not only about 100 billion. We need to mobilize the trillions. With respect to adaptation, we need to significantly increase financial support, especially for the most vulnerable countries. We need to accelerate the development and implementation of national adaptation plans. A clear path to solutions exists. I call upon all parties to recapture the spirit of multilateralism that resulted in the adoption of the Paris Agreement and fulfilled their commitments under it. Success is possible because we have the science. The data is unequivocal. Climate change is widespread, rapid, intensifying, and already impacting every region on Earth, on land, and in the ocean. But one number stands out above all others. We must limit global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees by the end of the century. The IPCC, the NDC synthesis report, and the emissions gap report all tell us, however, that we are not on that path. I call upon all parties to use science to inform their decisions at COP26 and act upon it. Studies and statistics tell one story. But we must look beyond the numbers to the human lives they represent. I have been to the small island states threatened by rising waters. I have talked to school children frightened for their futures. I have talked to women who bear the burden of climate change at home, but are shut out of the search for solutions the minute they go out of the door. I have talked to youth frustrated with what they see as a bleak future. The message they all have in common is this: they want to be included. They are right. If we are sincere in calling climate change a global issue, then total inclusion must be the foundation upon which this process is built. COP26 needs to ensure that all voices and proposals are considered. I encourage the engagement of observers and other stakeholders, and I call upon parties to incorporate their ideas in the discussions here at COP26. We are all facing the same climate emergency. We must all be part of the solution. Dear colleagues, the transition that we need is beyond the scope, scale, and speed of anything humanity has accomplished in the past. It is a daunting task, but humanity is a species defined by its ingenuity. More than two centuries ago, the world was completely transformed by the Industrial Revolution. It was an era driven by the technology and innovation of their day, but also one with the residual impacts of greater economic and social division, environmental damage, and climate change. We can and must learn the lessons of history. Let ours be an era defined by the prosperity of the many rather than the short-term gain of the few. Let ours be an era in which we have healthier relationships with nature. Let ours be an era in which we protect our land, oceans, and biodiversity. Let Glasgow be the starting point of this new era, this new age of resilience, and let COP26 mark its beginning. It's entirely within our grasp, but getting there depends on the completion of our work here. It depends on the full implementation of the Paris Agreement. It depends on more climate action. It depends on you. It depends on all of us. Dear friends, the task ahead of you in these 2 weeks is significant. But look at what you have accomplished just to get this far. Success is entirely possible. I encourage you to keep the big picture in mind. I encourage you to look beyond your specific agenda item to what we're trying to achieve together. I encourage you to consider the choices that we must make and the trust vested in you by billions. Let us rise to the enormous challenge of our time, this pivotal point in history, and achieve success for not just our present generation, but all generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Executive Secretary. The IPCC is currently in the process of preparing its sixth assessment report and has recently released Working Group 1's contribution to that assessment. I would therefore like to invite Mr. Hoisung Lee, Chair of the Intergovernment Panel on Climate Change, to address the plenary. Mr. Lee, you have the floor.
Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor for me to address you on behalf of the IPCC at the opening of the COP26. First, our sincere thanks to the UNFCCC Secretariat and the UK government for the successful preparation of this landmark conference. We are equally grateful to the Scottish government and City of Glasgow for this preparation and warm welcome. It is a privilege to speak about climate change science here in Scotland, endowed with a rich scientific life and home to giants such as Alexander Fleming, Mary Somerville, and of course Adam Smith, the father of economics, just to name a few. Today's scientific knowledge and its achievement stands also on their shoulders. Prior to this conference, the IPCC released in August the first part of its ongoing sixth assessment report. It clearly laid out for the policymakers and stakeholders the most up-to-date physical science basis for the understanding of the climate system and climate change. Make no mistake, it's a sobering read. It reflects the magnitude of the collective challenge for all nations on this planet. Science shows that changes in the climate are widespread, rapid, and becoming more intense and affecting every part of the region. Thanks to major advance in science since our previous assessment report in 2013, today we have a much more precise and clearer picture of how the climate system works, which let us understand better what has changed in the past and what is changing now and what can be the changes in the future on the climate system and why they matter for every region. It is now unequivocal that human influence is causing climate change, making extreme events more frequent and more severe. Some recent hot extremes, such as heat waves in the last 10 years, would have been extremely unlikely to occur without human influence on the climate system. Global warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius and 2 degrees Celsius will be exceeded during this century unless immediate, rapid, and large-scale reductions in greenhouse gas emissions, especially the carbon dioxide and methane, occur in the nearest future. We also bring a wealth of understanding about climate change at the regional level, which is critically relevant for shaping policies. I encourage everyone to seize the moment, seize the opportunity this gathering offers. We, the scientific community, are ready to work with you on understanding of scientific evidence of climate change, its impacts, adaptations, and how these translate into realities of climate action. We share one atmosphere, one climate system. It knows no borders. The true measure of the effectiveness of our collective efforts will be the state of its condition, and science will attest to that. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Lee. It is now my pleasure to invite His Excellency, Mr. Abdullah Shahid, President of the United Nations General Assembly, to address the plenary. Excellency, you have the floor.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, allow me to be candid, for you are family. We are facing an existential crisis. We have the capacity and resources to address this crisis, but we are simply not doing enough. We must be honest about this with ourselves, with each other, and with the rest of the world. We have had decades to argue the facts about climate change, but the power of renewables, about the fine details of monitoring or cost sharing. Yet, we have still failed to act with the conviction and determination required. That may be a hard truth, but it is the truth. Another truth, we are entirely capable of turning this around if we so choose. Excellencies, since assuming the role of the President of the General Assembly, I've heard more about climate change than any other subject. I heard it from every single world leader and delegate at the high-level week. I heard it on my travels from youth, from civil society, from local leaders, and from women's groups. I heard it last Tuesday at the General Assembly meeting on climate change that I convened ahead of COP26. While the intensity of their tones varied, their messages were one and the same. The urgency of keeping with 1.5 degrees target, the need to support vulnerable populations, the irresponsibility of not capitalizing on technological innovations, and the importance of empowering women and youth. I promised the membership of the General Assembly that I would bring this message to here, to Glasgow. First, renewable technologies are now among the cheapest on the planet and command strong public support. With the news that climate finance will not reach the promised goal of 100 billion annually until 2023, we must accelerate our efforts to ensure that all countries have access to the latest technological innovations. Second, nearly $100 trillion have been pledged to net zero targets by the private sector. Yet, it is unclear how they will be utilized, prioritized, or measured. It is imperative that their contributions are as efficient and impactful as possible. Third, we must maintain focus on adaptation, particularly for vulnerable countries. We must ensure there is an even 50-50 split in adaptation and mitigation financing. Fourth, green jobs are the future, promising both economic prosperity and environmental sustainability. We owe to the world's almost 1.8 billion youth to not only make the transition to blue and green economies, but to also invest in their skills and tap into their energies to make that transition viable. Excellencies, 6 years ago in Paris, we celebrated an agreement that committed us to keeping global temperatures from rising above 1.5 degrees. We pledged to protect those most vulnerable, and we acknowledged that this was a planetary problem that no country could go alone. Yet since Paris, it has rained for the first time on Greenland's summit. The amount of CO2 in the atmosphere has reached record levels. Heat waves have scorched countries around the world. Droughts, storms, forest fires, and floods have all become more intense, more recurrent, and more commonplace. And sea levels are rising, threatening small island states and coastal communities alike. My friends, we have the science, we have the resources, we agree on the urgency. What then is holding us back? My dear friends, only one variable remains, and it is us. We have to make the choice to address climate change. We have to choose the hard but necessary actions. We have to listen to the science and increasingly our global population who are demanding action. My dear, dear friends, we have run out of excuses. It is time to do the right thing. In the words of Frankie the dinosaur who addressed the General Assembly, let us not choose extinction. Let us work together as one global family and use the capacities and capabilities at hand to do what needs to be done. Let us get it done. I thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. Now, upon my special invitation, it is my pleasure to invite India Logan Riley, a representative of the Indigenous peoples, to address the plenary. India, you have the floor.
Tēnā tātou katoa. Hello, everyone. Ko kahuraniki, te maunga, ko tukituki te awa, ko ngaruroro te awa, ko tūtaikuri te awa, ko ngāti kangunu te iwi, tihei mauri ora. Ko India Mero Logan Riley aho. My name is India, and I am from a nation called Ngāti Kangunu on the east coast of the North Island of Aotearoa, colonially known as New Zealand. In February of last year, catastrophic climate change-filled wildfires tore their way across eastern Australia. The smoke cloud was so big that the sun turned red in my own homelands, far from the east coast of Australia. At that time, I was supporting my younger brother in hospital, and the doctors told us that they were seeing higher amounts of people with breathing issues related to the smoke in the air. In that moment, our health was bound to the struggle of the land and people in another country. In the impacts of climate change, our fates are intertwined, as are the historic forces that have brought us together today. Before we embark on these 2 weeks of negotiations, it is important to reflect on how we ended up in this room, with thousands of other people masked up and poised to deliberate. And to do this, I must go back hundreds of years into the roots of imperialist expansion and the story of my own community. 252 years ago, invading forces sent by the ancestors of this presidency arrived in my ancestors' territories, heralding an age of violence and murder and destruction enabled by documents like the Doctrine of Discovery that were formulated in Europe. Land in my region was stolen by the British Crown in order to extract oil and suck the land of all its nutrients while seeking to displace my people and end our practices. The first time I personally experienced these violent processes was at 10 years old, when the local council attempted to steal our community's land for the construction of a highway. And then after that, the New Zealand government stole the foreshore and seabed and offered it up for deep sea oil drilling the following year. These historic forces continue to shape my life and have brought me here. I have grown up in these negotiations, spending my 20s running through these halls, lobbying decision makers, and staying up far past midnight hand-stitching banners. Since my first climate talks in Paris, I've been giving the same speech. I've been applauded and awarded for conjuring emotive imagery of rising sea levels and yearly wildfires that my community continues to endure. 6 years ago, I first spoke these stories into this space, and every year since, I have repeated the same words: wildfires, sea level rise, wildfires, suffering, sea level rise, biodiversity loss, sea level rise. Emissions continue to rise. I'm the same age as these negotiations. I've grown up, graduated, fallen in love, fallen out of love, stopped and changed a couple of careers along the way, all while the global north, colonial governments and corporations fudge with the future. And as Indigenous, knowing that this history shows us that hands and minds made this present world, and so it is also hands and hearts and minds that can remake it. And it is Indigenous and frontline communities that are leading this remaking. We're keeping fossil fuels in the ground and stopping fossil fuel expansion. We're halting infrastructure that would increase emissions and saying no to false solutions. In fact, in the US and Canada alone, Indigenous resistance has stopped or delayed greenhouse gas pollution equivalent to at least one quarter of annual emissions. What we do works. In the face of mediocre leadership, Indigenous peoples shine through. This is all to say that climate change is the final outcome of the colonial project. And in our response, we must be decolonial, rooted in justice and care for communities like mine who have borne the burden of the global north greed for far too long. I cannot put it more simply than that we know what we are doing. And if you aren't willing to back us or let us lead, then you're complicit in the death and destruction that is happening across the globe. Rights frameworks must be entrenched in the Paris rulebook. Finance must be redistributed from the likes of war games in the Pacific towards loss and damage in a just transition. And richer countries have to commit to steep emissions reductions this decade, rather than palming off responsibility through carbon markets. And last but not least, land back, oceans back. This is all part of following Indigenous leadership. This is what keeping warming below 1.5 degrees looks like. This is an invitation to you. This COP, learn our histories, listen to our stories, honour our knowledge, and get in line or get out of the way. Kia ora. Thank you.
Thank you, India. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the end of the opening statements of COP26. May I please ask you to remain in your seats whilst we escort our guests from the podium. Distinguished delegates, I now invite the conference to consider sub-item 2B of the provisional agenda, adoption of the rules of procedure. The draft rules are contained in document FCCC/CP/1996/2. Parties may recall